Welcome back. Our next chapter is the Michelson interferometer. So the overall topic of this chapter is constructive and destructive superposition of waves. Interference, we talked about the double slit interference behind the double slit. We did talk about the interference effects observed on a thin film. Simple example, the soap bubble. The Michelson interferometer is an important other device. Actually, it goes back to Albert Michelson and Edward Morley. And Edward Morley. They did the experiment in 1887 in US, and they got the Nobel Prize for that in 1907. The experiment is remarkably simple. You shoot a laser with a fixed wavelength lambda on a beam splitter. It's a half reflecting mirror. It's positioned at a 45 degree angle, so part of the light is transmitted and part of the light is reflected from this beam splitter. We are placing two mirrors here, mirror one and mirror two. Light gets reflected and now passes through the beam splitter here and gets reflected here. And this is where we place our screen or detector. Either a screen or in our days we would use an CCD camera to detect the result. The arms have a certain length here, L2 and L1. And now, again, path difference. Delta L is L2 minus L1. Now, is that totally correct? I already left the space here. So think about it for a second. There's something missing here. What do I need to put here? Let's look at the experiment. The beam here passes the distance L1 twice, goes up and down. And so does the beam here on L2. So it's 2 times L2 minus 2 times L1. That's the path difference. And for maxima, the condition for constructive superposition of waves must be fulfilled, namely m times lambda. Delta L, 2 times L2 minus 2 times L1 is m plus 1/2 lambda. That would be the condition for minima. This is the Michelson interferometer. Why was that experiment so important that it was finally awarded with a Nobel Prize? This experiment was used to prove that the speed of light in vacuum, C0, the 299,700 kilometers per second, roughly, is indeed the upper speed limit in our universe. So they mounted that experiment on a table which can be rotated by 90 degrees. And now you have to think of the following. Here is the sun, and here the path of our Earth. And the speed of our Earth is actually pretty remarkable. It's a pretty high speed. They placed the instrument in the following, that the two arms were perpendicular to each other. Here the incoming light, and here the final screen. So one arm was pointing in forward direction. So in classical mechanics, you would call it speed of light plus the speed of our Earth. And the other arm was perpendicular to that, so just the speed of light. So here, C0 plus our Earth, and here, just C0. That's what we have learned from classical mechanics. Now they took the setup and rotated it by 90 degrees. Now they swapped the two arms and nothing happened. Same interference pattern. You can imagine that this is a super precise way of measuring distance changes. Nothing happened at all, which means for both arms, the same speed of light. So that one can be eliminated. Also, that arm experiences just the speed of light. That was a fundamental experiment, very simple on a tabletop experiment, very simple experiment, and the fundamental proof that the speed of light is indeed the highest possible speed of the universe. And that discussion here was the starting point for Einstein's relativity theory. This is why this experiment is so important. We have a current experiment here, actually, the gravitational waves. And I don't know if you, Sam, want to talk about that. My postdoc, Sam, is actually my cameraman here. The gravitational wave experiment in
the LIGO experiment.
Okay, right. I have a technical problem. Microphone doesn't pick up his voice. So the LIGO experiment, I'll show that on a PowerPoint presentation in US, was recently used to demonstrate that gravitational waves exist. Here, the same Michelson interferometer, but the length of both arms was about 5 kilometers. It was all positioned perfectly in vacuum tubes to eliminate any fluctuations in air. And they had high profile, highest quality mirrors placed here and here. Why I did refer to my postdoc here in the audience, these mirrors were coated at CSIRO here in Sydney at Lindfield in his, in Sam's former group. At CSIRO here. I recently visited the group, about that size, that thick glass bodies coated with a gold layer, ultra high precision. That was an amazing piece of work. So the here Sydney, CSIRO and Lindfield contributed to this experiment. And I show you a little bit more in my PowerPoint slides about that. That's the Michelson interferometer. And in the following, I wanted to calculate something with you. The Michelson interferometer can be actually also used to determine, for example, the index of refraction of gases. And I love that quick example because it also shows you how precise the Michelson interferometer in the end really is. So what we do now is we place a vacuum tube on both arms, actually, and fill that vacuum tube slowly with a gas. So the experiment and the example is Michelson experiment. Determine the index of refraction of air. So, at the first arm, we place a vacuum tube. Here we have a length L1 and an index of refraction N1 is 1. Vacuum 1.0 sharp. The second arm, we have a vacuum tube initially and we fill it with air. The length here is L2 and N2, this is air, this is what we want to determine. For simplicity, we assume that L1 is equal to L2. That can be built directly in your experiment. So, what's the number of wavefronts on arm 1? How many wave fronts fit in? This is N for the number of wave fronts in vacuum. This is 2 times L, 1 divided by lambda 1. And now, number of wave fronts on arm 2. This is N in air is 2 times L2 divided by lambda 2. And lambda 2 can be converted into lambda 1. We used that identity before. We get now 2 times L2 index of refraction of air divided by lambda 1. The experiment is running in the following. The starting point B both arms, both vacuum, both tubes on both arms are in vacuum. We now slowly fill the arm 2, vacuum tube here, with air, with the desired gas, and we watch on the screen how many maxima and minima we see during this process. So we count the number of maxima. The difference in maxima is the following. This is n air minus n vacuum. We pick up the numbers, 2 times L2 and n air divided by lambda 1 is minus 2 times L1 n air and lambda 1. For simplicity, we assumed, that's already written here, that L1 and L2 are equal. And now the entire equation can be written as 2 times L divided by lambda n air minus 1. So what we have to do in the end, we need the length of our arms, and we have to count the number of maxima. Count the number of maxima during filling of vacuum tube 2 with air. So let's calculate that. So quick interruption again. I'm using these quick interruptions actually to clean the board. Now a real experiment. We want to determine the index of refraction of air with a Michelson interferometer. What we do is we are using 2 arms. And arm 2, the length should be L1. Is equal to L2 is 5 centimeters. We use a helium neon laser. This one has 633 nanometer in wavelength, and we observe 43 maxima when we fill arm 2 slowly with gas. So the starting point is both arms are equipped with a vacuum tube. Both vacuum tubes are in vacuum. And we fill slowly gas, air in that case, into our arm L2. And we count the interference maxima on our screen. From the upper derived equation, we know that the number of maxima is 43, start slowly, delta n, is 2 times L divided by lambda n r minus 1. Let's put the numbers in. We count 43 maxima. We have 2 times 5 centimeter. We have a wavelength of 633 nanometer. And n r minus 1. We can bring this to the other side. N r minus 1 is, and now, 43 times 633 nanometer is 10 to the power of minus 9 meter divided by 2 times 5, 10 centimeters, and a centimeter is 10 to the power of minus 2 meters. This is now n minus 1. Important units are placed in between. It eliminates, and we get the final number of 2.77 times 10 to the power of minus 4. Last step, we can bring the 1 on the other side, and our final result is n r is 1.000277. This is how we can determine the index of refraction in air. It's a simple tabletop experiment, and it also demonstrates in a pretty convincing way how precise and accurate such a simple experiment like the Michelson experiment is to determine such tiny differences, like here, the index of refraction of air. Thank you very much for your attention.